Yes.
Yes.
So you can make it full slide. You can make it full slide.
Yes, sir, I'm doing that. So I discussed with the organizer as well, and as Dr. Satpathy rightly said, you know, we need to give some new twist to this. So we all know that there are a lot of comorbidities in heart failure. You know, for instance, rhythm abnormalities could be one, tachyarrhythmias, bradyarrhythmias. We could have ischemic heart disease as one etiology. Sometimes people have intraventricular conduction defects as one etiology. Even congenital heart defects, we all know, can present with heart failure. So I thought, I took their permission that maybe we can add a new twist to it, that how to use the ECG, how as physicians we can understand how to use a simple tool like ECG to understand what are the cardiac comorbidities or what are the diseases which can lead to heart failure. So if we look at the purpose of clinical evaluation of a patient of heart failure, we have been taught from medical school that not only should we be able to diagnose heart failure, but as Dr. Satpathy rightly said, assess comorbidities as well. And when we are assessing comorbidities, either by clinical examination or by any investigative modality, we should be able to derive some etiological clues, assess the severity of heart failure while excluding other causes, and of course, assess response of these patients to therapy. So can we use the ECG to, you know, understand these three points? ECG is at the cornerstone of not only diagnosing but evaluating heart failure patients, and often we overlook a simple thing like ECG. All patients with suspected heart failure should have a 12-lead ECG. We all know that, because the sensitivity and the specificity of an abnormal ECG for diagnosing or predicting underlying or incipient heart failure is pretty good. In fact, most of the guidelines also mention a normal ECG is quite unlikely in heart failure. So we'll just understand what are the etiological or what are the comorbidities we are talking about. As I said, you know, rhythm abnormalities, a wide QRS, can it predict heart failure? Few other things like hypertrophy or bundle branch block, how to diagnose old MI versus a new MI. We all know the old criteria, but I'll just tell you one or two new criteria as well, and a few other things. So first of all, coming to the part one of the talk, this is a 57-year-old who had ischemic heart failure. He had triple vessel disease, non-graftable vessels, ejection fraction was low. He comes with worsening pedal edema and recent non-compliance with drugs.
Your slide is not moving.
Oh, since when? I'll just share it again then. So that is the problem of presenting online. Can you see them now?
Sir, your first slide is open, your introduction slide, where your name is written. And after that, it has not moved. So please bring your presentation to full screen mode.
Right. Just a minute. I am at full screen now. Can you see? No.
Just click on the topic.
Just a minute. I apologize once again, and thank you for the help. Sorry for wasting your time. So I'll what I was trying to say, that I thought that I'll use the the power of ECG to assess comorbidities. We all know that the purpose of a clinical evaluation. Are they moving now?
Yes.
Thank you so
much. It's okay. Go on.
Thank you, sir. So we need to assess comorbidities, and my brief in the next 15 odd minutes will be how to use the ECG to derive etiological clues about diagnosing heart failure, assessing the severity of heart failure, and even assessing the response of these patients to therapy, because often ECG is an underdiagnosed tool. It should be at the cornerstone for diagnosing and evaluating all heart failure patients. All suspected heart failure patients should have an ECG, because to find a normal ECG in heart failure is very, very unlikely. We'll just understand these 6 or 7 points. You know, they are the various etiologies of heart failure which we encounter in clinical practice, either a rhythm abnormality, a wide QRS, bundle branch block, And a few words about even congenital heart disease, because this is often an underlooked or undiagnosed thing when patients come with heart failure. So I was trying to describe a ischemic heart failure patient who has coronary artery disease. He has low ejection fraction, comes with worsening pedal edema. And the ECG is this. So the purpose of showing this ECG, if a patient of heart failure comes with a sinus tachycardia, new onset sinus tachycardia, even that you should suspect that either the patient is having worsening heart failure due to non-compliance with drugs, as happened in this patient, or maybe perhaps some dietary indiscretion like increased sodium in diet, etc. So either we need to step up beta blockers, consider ARNI, or add ivabradine in these patients. Because if the patient is not responding to a beta blocker, adding ivabradine in these patients is often good. We all know that ARNI is now a good drug, and even it's been shown that for patients with worsening heart failure, it can be a good drug for persistent sinus tachycardia, and even ivabradine is a good choice. Now, this same patients come back 1 month later with palpitations, even more worse heart failure and near presyncope. So again, this ECG shows that in a patient of heart failure, new onset atrial fibrillation is a common cause for deterioration. As far as therapy is concerned, for these patients, you will try either rate control or rhythm control. Prefer rhythm control. That is, you will try to bring back these patients to sinus rhythm if the patient is very, very symptomatic from atrial fibrillation, or if it's a young patient. Otherwise, a simple rate control using calcium channel blocker or a beta blocker is good enough. So this patient, when the beta blocker was stepped up, he came after 2 weeks on a routine follow-up. And now if you see the ECG, it shows a atrial flutter slash fibrillation with a fixed AV response. So in a patient of atrial fibrillation and a slow regular ventricular rate, suspect AV nodal block, and you might need to scale down the dose of beta blocker. So not only sinus tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, but atrial fibrillation with a fixed regular rate, all these should make you suspect that the patient is having some problem in his heart failure therapy. Switching gears, 11-year-old girl who had heart failure with palpitations. This is the ECG. And if you look at the X-ray and the echo, X-ray shows a huge cardiomegaly. There is left ventricular dysfunction. So it's a long RP tachycardia. This tachycardia was coming from the lower part of the right atrium. And the point of showing this ECG is if the patient comes like this with a recent onset heart failure, palpitations, so it's very, very diagnostic of a tachycardiomyopathy. And often these patients are permanently cured by radiofrequency ablation, as happened in this patient, and the LV function is recoverable. So not only tachycardias, but even bradycardias. So this was a 75-year-old guy who had mild pedal edema. The X-ray is pretty unremarkable. He comes with some shortness of breath, fatigue. And if you look at this ECG now, so ECG shows you clear-cut AV block. So the point is that if an elderly patient comes with some mild heart failure, it's a good idea to obviously look at the ECG, because even in patients who are elderly, AV block can lead to heart failure because of loss of AV synchronization or loss of the atrial kick. So not only tachycardias, but even bradycardias can lead to heart failure, and ECG is often a good tool to diagnose. Another patient who had no previous history of coronary artery disease or diabetes comes with heart failure. The ejection fraction is documented to be low. The point of again showing this ECG, if the ECG in a heart failure patient is very, very wide, fragmented, intraventricular conduction defect, then you should suspect clearly from the ECG only that there is a myocardial scarring or the patient has got underlying heart failure. So if the ECG in a patient of shortness of breath shows a wide QRS, a fragmented QRS, you are pretty safe to diagnose a left ventricular dysfunction, which could be most probably it is due to a dilated cardiomyopathy or ischemic heart disease. This patient at some point of time also shows this ECG. So this shows, what is this? Or is this two QRSs? It's a bigeminal rhythm. But of course, one, if we blow up this ECG over here, it's not a bigeminy, because two QRSs cannot come in so close succession, because the ventricle will obviously be refractory by the first QRS. So they cannot come in so quick succession. And if you see over here, this is an extreme widening of the QRS. So that's pretty impressive. Looks like a bigeminal rhythm. And if you see, this is the P wave. So sometimes the QRS can become so wide, and this is like a fragmented QRS, that is an additional R or R prime or notching within the QRS, which looks like this if you see over here. So if a patient of shortness of breath, heart failure has a notched QRS, then invariably you will find that this is due to fragmentation of electrical forces. And this was the patient's echo. You see a usually dilated left atrium, left ventricle. The strain is completely abnormal. And these patients often do not do well because wider the QRS, poorer is the LV function. And these patients, it is clearly documented that the QRS width, as it completely increases, the patient's adverse events increase. So not only the tachyarrhythmias, bradyarrhythmias, but even the QRS duration teaches us a lot about the etiology of heart failure. And in fact, these patients are often prone to ventricular tachyarrhythmia, as happened in this patient. Voltage changes. So young patient of rheumatic heart disease, no past record, presents with heart failure. What are the likely lesions just from the ECG alone? So if we see, there is a left atrial enlargement, there is clearly left ventricular hypertrophy, and there is a right axis deviation. If you see lead 1 and lead AVF. So this suggests that apart from the mitral stenosis, which she had a rumble, she also has aortic valve disease and significant pulmonary artery hypertension, which was confirmed on the echo itself. So voltage changes, hypertrophy can also tell us a lot about the underlying etiology. Another patient, a 75-year-old female who had heart failure, no previous history of coronary artery disease. If you see this ECG, it shows low voltages. There is QS in the inferior leads and QS complexes in the precordial leads. So whenever in a patient of heart failure you find such a pattern, you will of course diagnose MI, but the low voltages are due to electrical cancellation of forces. So low voltage also teaches us that there is a myocardial scarring. So not only the QRS duration, but the low voltages also tell us that either it is a dilated or a ischemic cardiomyopathy, as was shown in the echo of this patient and subsequently confirmed by an angiogram. Very interesting, if this was a male patient, heart failure, peripheral edema, weight was 82. This was a ECG which shows a sinus rhythm. And ECG at discharge after IV diuresis, optimization of therapy, the patient lost nearly 14 to 16 kilos. So if you see, there is a pickup in the voltages, obvious increase in the voltages, which tells us a good diuresis. So again, this is a subtle point which is often missed. So if the ECG shows a pickup in the voltages, that tells us that either there is good diuresis or the ventricular function is improving. Presence of left bundle branch block alerts us to underlying structural heart disease. We all know that. So how to diagnose acute MI in the setting of a left bundle branch block? So I'll just show you an example. A patient comes with sudden shortness of breath. This was the ECG. So we have all been familiar with, this is just to revise the Scarbosa's criteria for diagnosing MI and LBB in the setting of an LBB. If you have a ST elevation, which is concordant with the QRS, a 1 millimeter elevation, or a 5 millimeter elevation in leads with a negative QRS, that is V1, V2, or any ST depression in leads V1, V2, V3, V4. So these are the Scarbosa's criteria. So if you look at this patient who had LBBB, in lead V3, he has a 5 millimeter ST elevation. In lead V5, he has a 1 millimeter ST elevation. So clearly the Scarbosa's criteria are satisfied and you can diagnose an MI. So this is an old literature. Recently, there has been reports that the sensitivity of the Scarbosa's can be improved by using the ST by T ratio. So what you do is, that if the patient comes with left bundle branch block and an acute coronary syndrome, what you do is, there is elevation over here, 5 millimeter. But what you do is that you divide the ST elevation by the depth of the S wave. If the ratio is more than 0.5, shall I continue, sir? Because I think my time is up. Shall I continue for another 5 minutes or is it okay?
You should. I think you should.
Should. Thank you, sir. And again,
very interesting. Very interesting.
So this is a, thank you, sir. So this is a good way to diagnose acute MI in a peripheral setting, you know, ECG. If you find the ST elevation divided by the depth of the S wave, the ratio should be more than 0.25. So this ratio was only 0.125. And now there is substantial literature to suggest that if the ratio is not more than 0.25, the chance of having an acute MI are pretty low. So this is a recent thing which I thought I should share. Secondly, when you get a left bundle branch block with a right axis deviation, that is a discordant axis. I'll show you an example. So left bundle branch block with a right axis deviation, this is a very, very specific marker for diffuse myocardial disease. So next time when we get a patient of, in the OPD who is getting an ECG and shows a left bundle branch block with a right axis deviation, it is a very, very good marker of underlying diffuse myocardial disease. And one should always do a good echocardiogram in such patients. Important thing, how to diagnose associated right ventricular dysfunction just by using an ECG in a patient who has got heart failure and underlying left bundle branch block. Four important signs: superior axis, a QR in AVR, clockwise rotation, that is R by S ratio less than 1 in V5, low voltage extremity leads, and high voltage in precordial leads. So this all four points in the setting of a left bundle branch block tell us that there is biventricular dysfunction. I'll just show you an example so that it sticks in the memory. What happens is whenever there is a normal LV and the RV, we all know the frontal QRS axis is directed inferiorly. Whenever there is left bundle branch block with normal function, the axis now becomes horizontal. However, when there is LV dysfunction, the axis is slightly superior, but when there is biventricular dysfunction, the axis becomes grossly superior. So what I'm trying to say is, if you look at these two ECGs, both have left bundle branch block, V1, V2, if you see. But if you see the axis is northwest in both, there is a QR in AVR, and there is a deep S wave in V5. So all these three points tell us that there is biventricular dysfunction. This is a very, very important and specific carry home message. Discordance, that is low voltage in the limb leads and high voltage in the precordial leads in the setting of a left bundle branch block, tell us associated biventricular dysfunction. So superior axis, QR in AVR, S in V5, V6, and voltage discordance in the precordial leads tell us just by the ECG alone there is biventricular dysfunction. Lastly, quickly coming to ischemia and a few words about congenital heart disease. So we all know that presence of a poor RV progression, persistent ST elevation tells us an old MI, and we all can do a history and we can do an echo to see if it's akinetic LV or not, but the real beauty is to diagnose it just by an ECG alone. So this is again a recent criteria that the logic is that if it's a recent acute coronary syndrome, then the T waves will be larger. So the T by QRS ratio will be higher. In fact, it is said that if any precordial lead has a T by QRS ratio of more than 0.3, you are safe to diagnose a recent acute coronary syndrome. I'll just show you an example. So if you see over here, V1, V2, V3, the T wave height divided by the QRS is more than 0.3. So this looks like a recent acute coronary syndrome, as opposed to this one. If you divide the T wave height by the depth of the Q wave, the ratio is clearly less than 0.2. So just taking the T wave height divided by the QRS tells us a recent or a remote MI. I'll finish off with this. A patient, 80-year-old, who had chest pain episode 4 years ago. So does he have an MI? If you see over here, it shows a right bundle branch block. But very importantly, note the QR pattern in V1, V4. So in a right bundle branch block, you always have a RSR pattern. If in a patient of right bundle branch block, you have QR in V1, V2, V3, it is very, very specific of an old anterior wall MI. So QR pattern in V1, V2, V3 in presence of a right bundle branch block. Lastly, this is often ignored when kids come to us with heart failure. So this was a 12-month-old baby who came in gross congestive heart failure. If you look at the ECG, it shows you Q in lead 1 AVL V5, V6 with ST elevation. So how can a 12-month-old infant have anterolateral or a lateral wall MI? So this ECG is classical of anomalous coronary L kappa, anomalous, you know, the L kappa anomalous coronary artery from the pulmonary artery. So the patient has an anomalous left coronary syndrome artery which comes from the pulmonary artery, and that is why the patient goes into heart failure. So these kids present at 6 to 12 months with a pattern of a lateral wall MI, and this is very, very diagnostic of a L kappa. Lastly, this is the last slide. Sometimes as physicians, we get these, you know, patient says ki mujhe ek bahar koi pacemaker laga hai ya CRT device laga hai for heart failure. These are cardiac resynchronization therapy devices. So three leads we put in the right ventricle, right atrium, and the coronary sinus. The patient comes to you and says, this is my ECG, whether it's normal or abnormal. So very, very important, simple clue. If it's a correctly placed device, what happens is, since we are pacing in the, from here, we are pacing in the coronary sinus or in the left ventricle, what happens is there is a prominent R in V1 and a QS pattern in V1, lead one. So this is the only thing we need to remember. R in V1 and QS pattern in V1, lead one. So whenever there is a problem in the device, you will not have this dominant R. You will have a small RS pattern in lead one, and you will have a dominant R pattern in lead one. So this is an important thing as physicians to remember. You just by an ECG, you can diagnose whether the device is working correctly or not. So to conclude, ECG is a very good tool, often ignored in heart failure. It can diagnose the etiologies ranging from tachy to bradyarrhythmias, hypertrophy, evidence of coronary artery disease, and even predict the response to therapy and predict prognosis. Thank you so much, and thank you for bearing with me and allowing me to explain.